method that evolved alongside the technological revolution did not need to accord anything to the supernatural. And in fact, the contrary became one of the crucial ethical principles of scientific community. And in what sense do I say this? See, in science, many scientists themselves might have very superstitious beliefs, but the scientific argument never entertains anything that is of such individual choice. Whatever the predilections of individual practitioners, they were not allowed to interfere with what was collectively recognized as validation of knowledge. So, for the latter, material evidence was the fundamental criterion. Okay, as this crystallized, the scientific method is a continuous process that begins with observations about the natural world. People, out of their curiosity, come up with questions about things that they see or hear, and they often develop ideas or hypotheses about why things are that way, are the way they are. The best hypotheses lead to predictions that can be tested in various ways. The strongest tests of hypotheses come from carefully controlled experiments that gather experimental data. Now, depending on how the additional tests match the predictions, the original hypothesis may require refinement. This is sort of rudiments of the scientific method. They may require refinement, they may require alteration, expansion, or even rejection. If a particular hypothesis becomes very well supported, then a general theory may be developed. So this is a certain, not just something that you practice, but it becomes a part of your philosophy, how you validate knowledge. Well, knowledge arises from various observations and inferences, etc. And then finally, we need to put together the whole body of knowledge, and that for that we need the validation, and the validation process involves the verification like this. This sets a model, to use the current word, template, so to speak, for inquiry into nature, the nature of things, and validation of knowledge that is far beyond the everyday practices of science. It's not, you might do your experiments without giving any thought to what is the underlying philosophy, etc. But behind all of that, collectively, we have this ethical principle of how knowledge is validated. There are a variety of difficulties in this course, both at the operational and theoretical levels, that we can come to later. That also will be a smart thing. But there are some fundamental features that stand out. One of the crucial tests about shaping the hypothesis is what's called the falsifiability. I'm sure many of you might have heard about it, but some of you may not have. So, testability of a hypothesis is of paramount importance. Hypothesis which cannot be tested, for instance, the statement that the earth is supported on the hood of a giant shesha, is something you can you cannot think of testing it. You cannot go under the earth and see whether there is a shesha or not. So such a statement has no place in the body of knowledge, even as a candidate. So falsifiability is what the technical term that people who discuss this have been using, and this is viewed as a primary criterion for if you do not have a test which can throw up a negative outcome, the statement which cannot throw a negative outcome, if it is to be negative, then such a statement is worthless. Now I want to discuss a everyday kind of example. a colleague once raised an issue as to how you can rule out the hypothesis that if a cat crosses your path, something bad will happen to you. This is a very common superstition that if you are crossing the road and then a cat crosses your path, then something bad is supposed to happen to you. Now, if you notice, and the argument is that if many people find it to be the case, it would be unscientific to deny it. That's the logic. So, I mean, that's the okay. But now, notice that the hypothesis is in fact not falsifiable, because first of all, since what is something bad is not defined at all, well defined. It's not something well defined and subject to one's point of view. In fact, something that is good from one's somebody's point of view may be bad for somebody else, and even it may be bad for the same person depending on how things develop. So something bad is not at all well defined. On the other hand, if the statement where something like a cat crosses your path, your blood pressure will go up in the next 5 minutes, then this is something of course testable. And if you come across, if you indeed come across many people saying that whenever the cat crosses that blood pressure goes up, then it's something, there is something to investigate and discuss why it happens. The common tendency among people who don't believe in this thing of the rationalist, etc., is to say that in case how will the cat know what is going to happen or what not going to happen. So in saying that, we are appealing to causality. We know there is a certain we know that many of the things that that we see around experience have a certain causal connection. Things happen, there is a certain sequence of things leading to that, and this idea of causality. And if you if something cannot have a cause, then there is no cause, then how can it happen? Now, there is a bit of a problem with this. I mean, this is also a valid explanation, but there is not entirely as satisfactory as noting that it is not falsifiable. So, it is that it may be that there are valid phenomena in which you don't know the cause that can happen. I mean, for instance, before the invention of telephone, if someone were to argue about communication across, it would seem that there is not possible. There is a certain cause involved, cause and effect involved, and that cannot happen. But so on the other hand, we do have a certain sense of cause that the causality that can be involved in the particular phenomena that we are discussing, and in this particular instance, it does make sense that to point out that cats will have no knowledge of, nothing to communicate by way of crossing or not crossing their paths. Anyway, that is just an aside. Other than falsifiability, one of the crucial things about the scientific inquiry is to come up with questions, the role of questions. The second major feature is the importance of coming up with questions as a means of enhancing knowledge. Since a question can in principle be answered in a variety of ways, so for instance, you ask a question and somebody says blah blah blah, so we need to have a way of judging the merit of the question, merit of the answers. So I just want to give another curious story. When I was a child, I read wise guy stories, as they call it, in which the king asks for the number of crows in the city. The wise guy cites a big number, say 2,573. Now the king wants it to be confirmed that's correct, but he's soon informed that to confirm it, one would have to first ensure that no crow should enter or exit the city pending the process of counting. Now, so abreast with the difficulty of the task, the king closes the matter, appreciating the smartness of the wise guy, and naturally, I mean, as in the stories, the reward in college. Now, even as I tried, I sort of had a feeling that there's something wrong with this, because if any answer a variety of numbers could be substituted for the given number, then where is the what's the value of that answer? There's no merit in that answer. Of course, it's an interesting funny story, and as children, I suppose children like it. Though I had my doubts, I didn't find other children to be unsatisfied with that. So, what are the value of the interest in the story? I just wanted to point out that the answers have a certain quality which can sometimes be misleading. In fact, and we need to judge the answers for their worth. The art of acquiring knowledge, whether in practical science or in the aspects of life, consists of asking good questions and being able to correctly evaluate the answers. The more typical and concrete situation involved is acquisition of knowledge is when, together with the question, you have a list of possible answers. potentially also with the possibility of expanding the list if needed. Now, this is not, though it might seem restrictive, if you think of it, it's not really a restrictive scenario. Given that testing the hypothesis, I mean, you have to, for validating knowledge, you are going to test hypothesis anyway. So now, unless you have a possible hypothesis to test, by which you test the answers to the question, you are not going to end up anywhere. So, given that testing hypothesis is an important part of the process for augmenting knowledge, want such a list to start is something very natural. Okay, so now I have to use my. There also needs to be possibility of expanding, because for instance, if you want to, you might happen to start with a question like, what is the color of a bird that is flying across the garden? And your initial list might consist of the simple colors, whereas you might find on examination that you need to have, maybe a shade of this and a shade of that and so on. So you might have to modify it. In other words, you may need to expand the list. But nevertheless, the process involves certain categorization of possible answers, the possibility of refining the list, and then that's how the process will go forward. The answers and understanding on most issues develops in steps, as we saw in this example itself. We might come to the answer only after a certain number of steps. The subsequent answers, in some cases, may rule out the earlier answer. So what you thought before might have to be completely discarded. So. just by way of an example, for instance, it was thought that the thoughts that we think, they come from the heart, because people notice that when they have intense feelings or they have intense thoughts, it's the heart that seems to be responding. But only after further accumulation of knowledge, people realize that it's not the heart that thinks, but it's the brain. So answers can shift as we go along. Of course, in this instance, the earlier answer was not tested, so that sense, or maybe you can say it was even tested in some form, but not the testing process itself can go through refinement. I mean, the correspondence that they would have made with the computation of thoughts and with associated with correlating with thoughts and processes, etc., might have seen the confirmation of some sort. So, but nevertheless, that test was not adequate, and with improved understanding, the answers would change. Of course, I'm sure many of you, each one of you, would be able to have your own example for this sort of phenomenon. I need not go further over that. So questions like whether C vitamin improves body resistance or not. I mean, as in fact, I think has gone through a seesaw of answers. On the other hand, so in some instances, the earlier answer may be subsumed by a later answer. And the classic example is the relativistic mechanics taking over the Newtonian mechanics. Now, it didn't mean the Newtonian mechanics is wrong. It's only a limiting case, and you see only you experience only the limiting phenomenon. That's the point. So, in a way, the Newtonian mechanics is whether the answer is yes, whether it's correct, yes or no. If you have to answer, then you have to say no. But that's not at all relevant because it is still valid as a limiting case of the relativistic phenomena. Now, there is a crucial thing in which questions in science are just sort of compared with ability of religion or theology or metaphysical systems to that deal with. Now, there is a general cliche that science concerns itself with how, whereas the metaphysical systems are equipped to answer why questions. That's the general cliche. The belief that people, I don't know whether you individually have met such people arguing that, but I certainly have, and this seems to be made out to be a fundamental difference between the objective or aim of science, whereas as compared to metaphysical systems, and it sort of can be compared to the primitive setup for that. Now, here to notice, it should notice. Now, it's indeed true, of course, that science is about how, right? I mean, and the issue of about why the art part is something complicated and complex and that needs to be understood better. Now, let me clarify a few points about that. In some questions, why is simply an equivalent of how. And here is an example. So, let's say you ask, why does the earth go around the sun? Okay, now it starts with why and might classify it as a why question. Now here, we use why simply because if you say how does the earth go around the sun, then it would be a question about the trajectory of the geometry of the trajectory. So that's not what you are asking, because you are asking something, the implicit implied question is something else. But on the other hand, if you modify the question, the same question, if you can put as how does the trajectory of Earth get determined? Okay, so now then you are on a clearer footing, and it's a how question. When you are asking why does the Earth go around the sun, you are actually asking how does the trajectory of Earth get determined to the Earth. To be around the sun, actually as an ellipse. This why question is actually a how question, and that science does address satisfactorily. And then you can use your knowledge of Newtonian theory of gravitation and on why the earth goes around the sun. Many questions asking for scientific reasons often get posed in this way. In this way, why is actually a how. So, for instance, again, another example is why is the weather in Mumbai humid? It's just that, how does it get humid? How do you happen to get so much humidity in Mumbai? And the answer you have is that it is at the sea. On the other hand, there are other why questions of other kind which are actually pointless. So here is one example. Why is man endowed with food sources on earth? Okay, that's a metaphysical question. And obvious answer is that it's by God's will. Now, the possible answer God's will is meaningless, as it neither it is neither falsifiable nor testable. For we are going back to the idea of how you validate knowledge, and that any answer to this question is really not testable. It's not a valid piece of can is not a candidate for to acquire knowledge. It doesn't help just to say that it's happening because of some supernatural process. And on the other hand, the question is also pointless, because if there are no food sources, we will not be here to ask the question and answer it anyway. So that's going round about around the question. So.